Hey guys, this is Swati Sneha and you are welcome to my YouTube channel Big Data Online School. I am continuing the video where I have left. Last time we have discussed difference between reduced by key and group by key. I hope you guys are clear with this. Alright, so we will be discussing some more transformations. So we will be starting from short by. What actually short by is, this is the transformation that works similar as order by. There will be some difference between order by and sort by. First of all, let's discuss what is actually sort by. Sort by takes two input parameters. The first input is a function that generates a key for each element in the source RDD, and the second argument allows you to specify ascending or descending order for sort. It will take two arguments, and first one will define the RDD and the second one will define whatever we have to do. We need to sort it as per ascending order or descending order. So here we are going to see example. Here we are going to create an RDD called numbers. So val numbers equals to, and we are getting some of the data from list of the data, that is 32415. Let me execute this command. So that we'll be having a RDD called numbers where we'll be having list of data. Here I'm pasting it. And here we have done the transformation where we are creating RDD called numbers, which is creating the data which is of list in as in 32415. Next we will see that we want to sort the data. Alright, we want to sort this data whether it is in ascending or descending form. So here you can see that we have created a RDD called sorted where we are going to sort the data that is there in RDD numbers, and we will put like numbers dot sort by, and it's like x tends to x arrow x comma true. So this would be the RDD operation that I want to perform, and this true means that I want to perform ascending operation. As we have mentioned, the second argument allows you to specify ascending or descending order for sort. So I am asking here to sort my data as per ascending order. Let me execute this command. See, it has done the operation, it has just sorted the data. That's why it is taking some time, and now we'll print out the data whatever it is sorting. So here you can see the data. It's like, first of all, like out of data 32415, you can see the sorting is done like 4 and 5 is done first as per ascending order, and then 1, 2, 3 is done, right? So this is not the normal sorting order that we used to see in our SQL's order by, right? What's the basic difference between sort by and order by? Sort by will sort your data as per the argument that you are giving us. Let's say it is ascending order or descending order. It will sort the data individually in blocks. It will not sort overall the data that is present with you. But if we go for order by, what it will do, it will just order the data. It will just sort the whole of the data and then it will give you results. As you can see here, that it is sorting the data, but first of all it will give 4 and 5 as in ascending order. Why? Because this 4 and 5 will come under, let's say, one block, and then again this 1, 2, 3 will be under one block. So it has just shuffled the data inside it, and it will show output as sort by operation in ascending way for this printl and output. Alright, so the difference between sort by and order by is, sort by will sort the data of the block. It will sort the data of block only. It will not sort the overall data, whatever is there. It will just shuffle the data and it will just sort the data of the block. But order by will order whole of the data and it will give you the output. If we are doing order by instead of this sort by operation, what it will give there as a result? It will give result as 1, then 2, then 3, then 4, then 5. Let's move into another transformation called join. I know you guys are already knowing this join operation. So here also we have four kinds of join, as in normal, inner join, right outer join, full outer join, left outer join. We'll be having two RDDs and we want to join that two RDDs. See, here we'll see an example. We have a RDD called pair RDD1 that has a list of key value pairs. Key as A and value is 1. Again key as B and value is 2. Again key as C and value is 3. Here I am going to execute this. I have created a RDD called pair RDD1. Now I want to create another RDD called pair RDD2. We have created two RDDs called pair RDD1 and pair RDD2. And now we are going to perform inner join operation. So how we'll perform inner join operation? We'll do first pair RDD dot join, and then in bracket we have to write second pair RDD name, as we have done in join operations. So let me perform this operation. I have joined the data and I have put it in RDD called join RDD. Let me print this join RDD so that we could see the result. Here we can see that our data has been joined. First of all, we had data as A1, B2, C3 and again we had data as B2, C3 and D4. So in inner join, as you know, that only the common pair of data will be shown. So the common pair of data in between our pair RDD1 and pair RDD2 is B. Here also BC is present. So we'll be getting output as B and C only. See, we are getting output as B and 2 and 2nd as per the value. And here also the key is C and value is 3 and 3rd. Alright, this way we can perform other join operations also, like right outer join, full outer join, left outer join and so on. I hope you guys are clear with join. Next we'll go for another important transformation, that is nothing but repartition. What actually repartition is? The repartition method takes an integer as input and returns an RDD with specified number of partitions. It is useful for increasing parallelism. First of all, let me tell you, repartition will shuffle your data and it will increase parallelism while processing your data. The partition method can be used to either increase or decrease the number of partitions in a data frame. Let's say we'll be having the set of data 1 to 100 and we want it to be partitioned as 10. So in each and every partition there will be 10 digits, from 1 to 10, from 11 to 20, from 21 to 30 and so on, right? But if we want to increase the number of partitions, we can use this repartition method. And what we'll get? We'll get the increased number of partitions and hence the parallelism will be increased. See, here we are going to perform the same operation that I have explained. Here we are going to create a list of numbers from 1 to 100 and I want it to be partitioned by 10. So that 10 number of partitions would be there for this digits from 1 to 100. Let me execute this command. This digit is from 1 to 100, it's partitioned for 10 number of partitions, okay. So if I want to see how many partitions it is taking, how we'll do, we can see partition like this. To see the number of partitions, we have these three mechanisms. We can apply this method and we can see the number of partitions. Let me apply this and let me check what is the number of partitions for RDD numbers. So it will show you that partition number is 10, as we have already defined that the digit from 1 to 100 will be having 10 partitions. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to repartition data. I want the partition to be increased from 10 to 15 so that the digits will be shuffled around the cluster and it will be shuffled around 15 partitions now instead of 10 partitions. So let me execute the data. Now I have already asked it to repartition my data from 10 to 15, right? So if I'm going to again execute and want to know how many partitions are there, we can perform the operation like this. Now what we'll see, we will see that instead of 10 partitions, we'll be having 15 number of partitions. See, the partitions have been increased from 10 to 15. By this, we can increase parallelism. How? Because now we are assigning, we are distributing our data across the cluster in order to process it and get the result. Next we'll go for coalesce. Coalesce and repartition is almost same thing, just a very significant difference is there, and this makes coalesce more better than repartition. First let me explain coalesce, then I'll explain the difference between repartition and coalesce. So what actually coalesce is? The coalesce method reduces the number of partitions in a data frame. It takes an integer input and returns a new RDD with the specified number of partitions. As we have performed the operation that we have digit from 1 to 100 and we were doing partitions of 10. So in repartition, what we have performed? There we have performed that we were increasing the number of partitions from 10 to 15, due to which we got increased number of partitions and the data was shuffled whole around the cluster. And because of this, parallelism was increased, right? But here the opposite scenario we are seeing. It's like we want the data to be stayed in less number of, reduced number of partitions. So here as you can see the example, first of all I'm initializing 1 to 100 of data and ask the data to be partitioned in 10 different nodes. Now what I'm performing coalesce operation, and now I want my data to be present in just 2 of the partitions instead of 10 partitions. Let me show you here by executing the query. See, the same operation I did that I have done for repartition. Now let me perform coalesce operation. I asked my data to be recollected. I asked my data to be there in only 2 partitions. If I want to see how my data looks like in partition. I'll just put this, and here you can see we had 1 to 100 of data, right? Now we have asked it to be coalesced into two only, so there must be only two kind of partition. Here you can see in bracket, in first bracket the data is there till 50, right? And in second array bracket the data is from 51 to 100. So the data is distributed now in only two partitions instead of 10 partitions. Alright, so this way coalesce is going to reduce the number of partitions if you want it in your project. Now I want to let you know the difference between repartition and coalesce. First of all, I want to say the basic difference between repartition and coalesce. The basic difference is we generally use this coalesce to reduce the number of partitions. Okay. But we generally use repartition to increase or maybe decrease the number of partitions. This coalesce uses existing partitions only to minimize the amount of data that shuffled. See what happens? I have done this practically, so I am letting you know. Like if you perform some of the operations like repartition and coalesce, and if you write the data, you can see the result. So here if we have 1 to 100 of data, and if we are listing the data out into 10 number of partitions. So how it will be? Like 1 to 10 in one partition, 11 to 20 in another partition, 21 to 30 in third partition, 31 to 40 in fourth partition, and so on till 100. Now if you are going to coalesce your data, it will just not shuffle your data, it will try to reduce the number of partitions, and the data will be stored like from 1 to 50 the data will be stored in one partition, and from 51 to 100 the data will be stored in another partition. But on the other hand, if we go for repartition, let's say here we wanted to increase the partitions, right? But let's say we are discussing the same thing that we have discussed in coalesce, that we want to decrease the number of partitions. Let's say we have that data that is from 1 to 100 and it's partitioned into 10 partitions. And now I want to decrease the number of partitions using repartition only to 2. So the data would be repartitioned, and the data would be shuffled across the cluster. As we have seen in coalesce, the data was from 1 to 50 in one partition and from 51 to 100 in one partition. The data would not be like that in repartition if we do here. If how it will be? It will be shuffled across the clusters. It will be shuffled across the partition, and we'll get two different pair of data sets. It's not like from 1 to 50 we'll get one set of partition and from 51 to 100 we'll get one set of partition. No. It could be like in one partition we'll be having 1, 3, 5, 10, 20, 21, 26, 30, the 50 digits, and in another partition rest digits will be there. So this could be shuffled around in the cluster. As I have discussed that repartition data will be shuffled across the cluster, but coalesce data will not be shuffled. It will try to reduce the number of partition and it will try to give us the result. I hope you guys are clear with repartition and coalesce. So now we have covered almost all the important transformation that we are going to use in our real-time project. Now we'll move to actions. So we have already seen transformation, now it's the turn of actions. So what is actions? As we have discussed, actions are the method that returns a value to a driver program. Whenever we perform action, then only the whole of the execution will be flown and we'll get the output in the driver program as a result. Here we will see few important actions. First of all, we'll go with collect. So what is collect? It is the action that returns all the data from the worker node to the driver program as an output. As the definition suggests, the collect method returns the element in the source RDD as an array. This method should be used with caution since it moves data from all the worker nodes to the driver node. We need to be a little cautious if we have a large set of data, because it will just get whole of the data from executors, worker nodes, and it will just move the data to the driver program. So if the large set of data set we are working with, so there will be chance that your driver program will be crashed. So be cautious while using this collect operation. Let me show you an example here how we can use it. Let's say we want the data from 1 to 10,000 as list, and we are putting that in one RDD called RDD. Let me execute this. Now I want to perform some filter operations. I want my filter operation as the data that is divisible by 1000, that data only we need as output. So we'll be performing this operation as the RDD name that we have created, and then filter operation, and then the mathematical calculation that we want to perform. So I'm going to execute this code. So it will filter out the data and put this in RDD called filtered RDD, and it will show the result from 1 to 10,000, the data that is divisible by 1,000. Let me get the output. So how we will get the output? We will just write collect operation. So what it will do, it will just collect whole of the data from all the worker nodes to the driver program. Let me execute this and it will show us the result. How it will show us the result? Now we are not doing printing or something. Now we are performing action. So what it will do? It will just backtrack it and it will perform the operation, right? So first of all, it will see where my filtered RDD is. There it will, like, it will go to filtered RDD, and from there it will see where my parent RDD is, and it will go to this RDD named as RDD. We already have seen these things, right? We have learned these operations. So let me perform collect operations over here. Once we performed collect operation, now here you can see the data from 1 to 10,000 that is divisible by 1,000. The multiples would be 1,000, 1,000, 3,000 and so on till 10,000, right? This way we will be getting data once we put collect as action. Next we will see count operation. As the name suggests, the count method returns the count of the elements in the source RDD. Let's say we have data from 1 to 10,000 and we want it to be counted. So the result would be obviously 10,000 because the number of data is 10,000. Let me execute this command. Once I write an action on this RDD, it will just give me the result. It will just give me the output. So here we can see the count of numbers from 1 to 10,000 is 10,000, right? So this way it will give us the count. Next collection we will see as count by value. The count by value method returns the count of each unique element in the source RDD. It will just return each unique element. Okay. It returns an instance of map class containing each unique element. It's count as a key value pair. So generally count by value will refer it for only key value pair. So let's see an example. Here you can see we are listing the data and storing it in one RDD called RDD. Here we are listing the data from 1, 2, 3, 4, right? And now we want it to be count by value. So what it will count? It will count the appearance of number of this data. Let's say we have 1. So how many times this 1 is appearing here? 1, 2, 3, 4. So the key would be 1 and its value would be 4. Again, the same thing will goes for 2. The appearance of 2 is 1 time, 2 time and 3 time. So the key would be 2 and the value would be 3, right? And so on. Let's execute this command. Now if I perform this count by value, you will see the output as key value pair there. We are getting output as key value pair. As we have described that 1 is occurring 4 times here, 1, 2, 3, 4. So we will getting the result as key value pair. This will be key and after arrow symbol we will be getting value pair, right? So it is key and value pair. I hope you guys are clear with this count by value. Next we will go for reduce action. The higher order reduce method aggregates the element of source RDD using an associative and commutative binary operator provided to it. It is similar to the pole method, however it is not required a neutral zero value. I'll explain this pole method later. First of all, let's concentrate on this reduce method. So as the name suggests, it will try to reduce the data whatever you have. Here in this example, we'll be going to take the data as a list and we'll be going to sum up whole of the data and reduce it. Let me execute this. We have taken the list of data as 1, 2 and 3 and 5. Now we want the data to be reduced and the sum to be performed. Like x, y and then arrow symbol and then x plus y. This means that 2 plus 5 plus 3 plus 1. So it would be summed up as 11. Since we have performed this reduce operation, so it will give us the summed up result. So what it will give? It will give us 2 plus 5 7 plus 3 as 10 and plus 1 is 11. The result would be 11. And in the other hand, if we see the product, it will give us x comma y and then arrow as x into y. So it will just multiply whole of the data. 2 into 5 is 10, 10 into 3 is 30 and 30 into 1 is 30 only. The result would be 11 and 30 for this case. This way reduce operation works and it will try to reduce the data. Next we'll go for lookup method. As the name suggests, it will look up the data. We have also seen this lookup method in some other tools also. So the same way it will work here also. Let me just read the definition over here. The lookup method takes a key as input and returns a sequence of all the values mapped to that key in the source RDB. Let's say here we have a list of key value pair where we have A, B, C as key and its corresponding value is 1, 2, 3, 11, 22 and 1. Now I want to look up the data, look up the value of A. So what it will give, it will get the value of that lookup. Let's say we are going to look up the value of A. So the corresponding value of this key A is 1, 11 and 1. Let me execute the command so that we can see the result as 1, 11 and 1. Here we have just executed this list of data. Now we want to look up the data. See, here we are getting result as 1, 11 and 1 as the name suggests. And in the other end, if you want to do for B, we will get 2 and then 22. This way, this lookup will be performed. This is very important for our project purpose because we generally use this lookup in real time. Next, we'll go for another action that is save as text file. Here what it will do, it will just write your file. It will just save your file as text file. Let's say we have some of the log file and there we want to do some of the filter operations. And after doing filter operation, we want that to be saved as text file. So that will save your file in your local disk or wherever you want, may it be in Hadoop system or may it be in local disk. Let me show you an example. We are creating an RDD called log where we are getting data from file. Let me execute this. So now I have logs as RDD and I'm getting this file from my local disk. Now I want to put a filter on this logs RDD. The filtered condition is like where in whichever line that contains error or the line whichever that contains warn, that should be filtered out and present under this RDD called errors and warning. Let me execute this command. See, in this errors and warning, the lines will be stored that contains error or warn. Now I want this RDD to be saved. Why? Because I want the lines that contains error or maybe warn. So let me save this file. So I want to save this file in my local disk only as under home as the user and then big data and under errors and warning folder. So once I save this as save as text file, it will just save the data in my local disk. Let me go into my local disk. As the path suggests, I am under home as the user and big data. Here my big data folder is. And as per the actions, a folder should be created as errors and warning. Let me check under this big data. Yeah, errors and warning file is created. And under this, we must have some of the files that should contain error or warn as line. So let me open this and let me check. The lines that we got here as filtered operation, here you can see one is there, again one is there, again here one is there. So we have got files that contains filtered operation that contains only one or error as the word in line, right? This is the action operation that we can perform save as text file. So we have covered few of the important actions that may be used in real time projects. So what we have covered collect, count, count by value, reduce, lookup, save as text file. I hope you guys are clear with workouts of transformations and actions in Spark, which is very important. Next, we'll go for one important part again, that is called RDD caching method. As we have already learned that there are three methods to create an RDD. One from the file, second from another RDD, and the third from the cache or maybe memory, right? So here we will see that method only. The RDD class provides two methods to cache an RDD, cache and persist. So by default, cache is going to store my data in memory only. Okay. And in persist, we'll get the options to put as argument whatever we want. Like if we want to put our data in memory, so we will just write memory underscore only. Or maybe if we want to put our data in disk, we have to put argument and we have to give the disk thing here. So let's see what actually cache means. The cache method stores an RDD in the memory of the executor across a cluster. Why it will put like this? So that it will be easy to access. It essentially materialize an RDD in memory. So whenever we want to get the data, we don't need to perform any kind of transformations operation. We just get the data from the memory only. Here we already have a file called errors and warnings. So that we are going to do cache, that we are going to put it in our memory here. Let me put it in memory. I have cached it. Now this error and warnings file are there in my memory. Now I want to perform some of the filter operation on that file that I have put it in cache. So I am doing a filter operation that whichever line contains error, I want to get the data in one RDD called error log, and whichever line contains warn, I want to get the data in warning log. Let me execute this command. I want to put all the error lines under error and warning RDD in error log, and now I want to put all the lines under error and warning RDD. I want to put all the warn lines under another RDD called warning log. So here we have done the transformation. Now it's time to count the number of records. So the error log that we have created, this RDD has how many number of records? We can see as from count. We will see that there are 16 number of lines that contains error. We have already stored this in error count RDD, right? And if we are going to see that how many number of lines are there that contains warn, we will see that there are 275 numbers of lines are there that has warn. As I have shown you here also, in this file we have seen so many warn is there, warn as a word, right? And you can see here error is less only here. Error, here also error is there, here also error is there. So as per the file, we got the data as we have number of lines for warn as 275 and number of lines for error as 16. So this way we can use cache, we can just utilize the memory, we can just store our data in memory, and you can just reuse that data again and again from memory instead of hitting data from our local file system or disk or anywhere else. I hope you guys are clear. Next we'll go for persist. So what actually persist or unpersist means? The persist method is a generic version of cache method. If we are just writing persist and a bracket, this means cache that we are going to store in memory, right? It allows an RDD to be stored in memory, disk or both, as we are discussing. It optionally takes a storage level as an input parameter. See here, if you can see, I want my error and warning to be persist. If here in bracket we are not writing anything, this means that we want to be cached. So if we write cache or persist with empty bracket, this means the same only, both are same. If persist is called without any parameter, its behavior is identical to that of cache method. Okay, but if we are putting some of the argument that says that I want to store my RDD in disk, then it means that I want to store my errors and warning RDD's data in the disk. So this way persist works. Persist and cache are same if we don't put any argument in the bracket of this persist. But if we are putting argument here, then it will be like storing in maybe disk or maybe some other space or like that. Maybe in disk or some other space. This way cache and persist differs from each other. In this video, we have covered whole of the transformations that we have left yesterday, and then we had started actions and completed the same, and also we had covered RDD caching methods, that is cache and persist. I hope you guys are clear with this. Thank you for watching.